3. A kdo používáte DeFi k tomu, abyste se trošku napákovali a byla sranda? Super. A koho DeFi vůbec nezajímá? Slečna. Ale to, když to někde zamkne a něco vyfarmaří, pak vám koupí pěkný boty za to. To je jedno, ne, koupit vám boty může stejně. Přátelé, o decentralizovaných financích a o tom, jestli do budoucna budeme nebo nebudeme potřebovat banky a bankovní systém, bude mluvit dáma, hele, to je hrozně hezký, že je taky ženská na tom pódiu, která ví, o čem mluví, protože i její zásluhou používají kryptoměny lidé v Jižní Americe, kde ta finanční situace není úplně ideální a je to asi ten nejlepší ostrašující případ, kam to nechceme dotáhnout. Podíváme se na DeFi v praxi a na to, jak decentralizované finance můžou fungovat a nemusí to být nutně jenom pákování pozic a hrabání velkých peněz, ale můžeme to přenést i do reálního života. Jani, máte slovo.
Ďakujem pekne. So, hello everyone, my presentation will be in English. I hope you don't mind, because there is some like non-Czech, non-Slovak speakers. But feel free to submit your questions in Slovak or Czech. I am Slovakian by origin, so it is my pleasure to be here. And first of all, I would like to know who I speak to. So, any people working in traditional finance here? Okay, one hand. Yay. Any people working in lending applications specifically? In lending, okay. Any people working on some governmental blockchains, EU grants, okay. Any developers? Okay, some, thank you. Who heard of Ethereum? I assume, okay, a big majority. Who heard of compound.finance? Okay. Great one. Who heard of AMMs, such as Uniswap? Okay. Who heard of sushi? But not the food. I have to disappoint you. Who heard of sushi token? Okay. Who is a farmer? No farmers here. But I think after this presentation, some of you might become farmers. It's actually good news, maybe. You'll see. And who heard of me? Okay, thank you. So now, maybe, time to introduce myself. As mentioned, my name is Jana Betkanič. I am Slovakian by origin. I live in Frankfurt. I graduated from Master's of Science in Applied Mathematics. I worked as IT Services Manager at Accenture and Forecast Analyst at Henkel. So that was until 2016. And then I discovered this big thing called Bitcoin and blockchain, and I realized the potential. Actually, I heard first time of Bitcoin in 2012. But I ignored, we all make mistakes in our lives, yeah? So let's call this a big mistake, but I got into the industry in 2016. I was running an NGO to fight the food waste in Slovakia as well, and since early 2017, I'm a full-time blockchain consultant. I was consulting Dutch government. I lived 3 years in Amsterdam, and I was consulting them for some blockchain applications. So it was government, banks, and law firms. That was somewhere 2017, 2018. And now I'm consultant for DeFi applications, and I'm a co-founder of Eldorado.io. I will explain later what Eldorado is doing. So what you can expect today is why DeFi matters. I watched some talks today, and yeah, so In some presentations, we can see that DeFi is abbreviation for degenerate finance. I have to say, this is not true. DeFi is decentralized finance. We'll touch like some reasons why DeFi can matter in long run. We'll also explain what is DeFi actually. We'll show some examples of DeFi products. We will also address some problems with DeFi. It's very important to realize that DeFi is at its early stage, so there is a lot of issues. So therefore, I'm very happy to welcome you all here and happy to share my knowledge, because you never know, like, maybe it's your future working opportunity. Okay, but before we jump into the DeFi itself, I would like to make sure that we all understand blockchain and the purpose of blockchain in the same way, more or less. So let me spend the next 3 minutes by explaining you why blockchain matters. So value transfer today occurs at three levels. So first, think of a supply chain. So we have a production of pineapples somewhere abroad, and we are delivering them to Czech Republic, right? So to every product in the supply chain, there is some information attached. So this is what we call information flow. Then we have some financial aspect of the supply chains attached to every product. So this is what we call very roughly money flow. And then we have a product itself, so the pineapple traveling to Czech Republic. So this combined is called supply chain, but when we leave the third level out, we can call this a financial system. This is very like very high level overview. So okay, this is something what all of you are familiar with. When you want to send money from bank A to bank B, what happens? Bank A and bank B, they communicate over internet, they send some inquiry to each other. And the point here is that communication is transmitted through internet, but the value flow and actually the reason why banks have so much power is that we trust them, that they are very good at maintaining the value. So when I have my, let's say, 50 euros in the bank account, and I want to send someone the 25 euros to their bank account, I trust my bank that when tomorrow I look into my bank account, there is still the money, the amount of money I expect. But let's have a look how this can change through blockchain and what is the potential use case for around 2 billion people who are unbanked. So let's have a person A and person B. They want to transact with no intermediary, so with no bank who we have to trust. So of course there is some information like sent over through internet, but what is very important to address here is that it's blockchain as the protocol layer sitting in the internet which facilitates the value flow. So blockchain in very simple terms, the purpose of blockchain is that it removes the middleman and I can send something which is of a value to someone across the world in an instant with instant settlement and with no, fees is a discussion for later, but I don't have to trust anyone. I trust cryptography, I trust mathematics, I trust the hardware, I trust the distribution of the system. So your takeaway may be transaction of a value across internet can be facilitated by blockchain. So we'll come to Internet of Values. This is as early as Internet of E-commerce in 2000, for instance, or Internet of like blogs or recipes or content creation in mid-90s. Okay, let's have a look why DeFi, why decentralized finance may be the next big thing, but not now, but maybe in long term, 10 years, 15 years, why this has the potential to go mainstream. In some talks today, there were some issues addressed with the current financial system. Needless to say that now 2020 has been pretty crazy, right? And we saw a lot of like governance steps from central banks or from other monetary institutions, which we cannot do anything about. We just can observe but we'll speak about this later. Okay, so why DeFi can matter? The first thing, interest rates. So interest rates is a very interesting thing because even if we forget Bitcoin, blockchain, DeFi, we still have current situation as follows. So we have national banks offering us certain rates, which are relatively low, but then online banks are doing way better at offering us better interest rates. Question is, how do they do it? And the answer is very simple, because they are online banks, so they don't have any buildings, they don't have many employees to pay for. They are better at streamlining the process, which traditional financial institutions just cannot keep up with, because when you have a bank which is 100 years old, then of course the bank, when it comes to innovation, some of the banks, they are built on COBOL. I'm not sure if you are familiar with COBOL, but COBOL is a very like old programming language. And there is many issues attached to it. So even forgetting Bitcoin, blockchain, and streamlining process through smart contracts, we still get very interesting situation when it comes to interest rates. Then the second reason why DeFi can matter in long term is emerging economies. Emerging economies is a topic which no one likes to touch because it's a high-risk environment, and it's very, regulation is very tricky. So I will show you in a few minutes, in a few seconds actually, our use case from Venezuela called El Dorado. But what I would like to say here is that financial system is a geographical lottery. You are either lucky enough to be born in a developed country that protects fundamental human rights, or you are born into an oppressive regime that suppresses economic development and the standard of living. So this is a very important moment to realize, like, our wealth and what we have here may be also the result of someone else struggling in their economy. And many times those people, they are no different than us in terms of drive, in terms of passion, in terms of what they want to accomplish in their lives. They're just born in the wrong place. So let's have a look at our El Dorado. I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with Venezuela and the crisis, but there is a very deep crisis in Venezuela. There is hyperinflation. Money loses value like 7% a week. When I was there in December 2019, we would go to grocery store, let's say Monday, and the next Monday, the prices would change by 7 to 10%. Of course, not down, but up. Salaries wouldn't change. So the situation in Venezuela is very like, okay, when looking at the spectrum, Venezuela is at the very far left of the spectrum. It's maybe the worst monetary system in the world now. How does it look in practice? So you would have people carrying some cash around. I mean, this picture is pretty old because 50 bolivares worth banknotes are not used anymore. They are not in circulation. But the problem is, how do those people access the services and the commodities and the products which are in the market? Because the only issue they have many times is that people, they cannot pay for it. Because there is either no application or the store of value is non-existent. Therefore, in Venezuela, there is many users of Bitcoin, actually, and many users of Dash cryptocurrency. So when I was in Venezuela, December 2019, $1 was 40,000 bolivares. Here we can see $1 is 300, almost 50,000 bolivares. So this is the inflation measure you can refer to. And in practice, it looks like this. So if you were to buy like a chicken, you see, so this is the amount of the banknotes you might be required to bring to the grocery. is as bad as Weimar Republic, for instance. And when we think of it, okay, so people, it's very, the problem is that those people, they would love to convert bolivares into something else, so it doesn't lose value so much. But the problem is only the technology. The technology is non-existent in many cases. And there hasn't been any app adopted mainstream yet because also of the government efforts. Government, of course, they don't like to see people escaping the monetary system. Also very common in Venezuela is barter, obviously, as a sign of economy in deep crisis. So Venezuelan government is also very interesting by the fact it's maybe one of the few governments in the world who is looking into blockchain cryptocurrencies with a lot of interest. It's been like this since many years. Some of you may have heard of Petro cryptocurrency. So Petro, Petroleum, was supposed to be cryptocurrency pegged to oil, national oil reserves of Venezuela. Of course, there are many, many problems with transparency of the project, and seems that it was only money printed out of thin air, and the government completely screwed up on integrating this cryptocurrency to the people. For instance, my colleagues who are in Venezuela, there is six of them, they received an airdrop for Christmas as a thank you from the government. And it was an airdrop worth maybe $50, $50 worth Petro. And what happened is that they received this in their wallets. As you saw, like outside Satoshi wallet or other wallets. So also Petro has his wallet. And they received all of a sudden, wow, like 100 Petros, which was worth $50. Now the problem was there was no liquidity in the market. No one wants Petro. none of the merchants, they want petrol. So the only market you could go and cash out the petrols to was a black market, and they would charge people 200% premium. So this is like a symbol of petrol. And what you can see in Caracas is obviously like, propaganda, advertisement, like we are a great government and we'll facilitate everything what you want and what you need. I mean, in terms of water supply, food, electricity, internet and so forth. This everything is in Caracas, in Venezuela, for free. But it also comes with certain problems when it comes to quality and customer support. When you think of the internet, for instance. And right next to it, you would have advertisement for some cryptocurrency service. People there are desperate for some solutions, some technology-based solutions, which would help them in an instant. Okay, the third reason why DeFi may matter, and here I apologize, but I forgot to add the slide, but it's process streamline. So if you think of smart contracts, so smart contracts are small scripts sitting on top of a blockchain, which have the potential to create conditioned payments. So when I say that, okay, send 5 Ethereum to this wallet when this event occurs, this is possible with smart contracts. And when we think of lending applications like peer-to-peer lending, when we think of investment applications, as here was a presentation earlier, when we think of like a lot of opportunities we have not only in emerging economies, but also in our traditional financial environment, a lot can be improved through process streamline and through DeFi. Fourth reason why we might be interested in exploring DeFi is people in power. So when we think of it like on a bigger picture, let's take the biggest macroeconomics picture we can get, and we end up having few entities having just a lot of power, whereas they don't have any interest in how do we feel? How do we feel about this crisis, what's going on? How do we feel about the lowered interest rates of central banks? No one has ever asked us, and of course we are not happy, there is not much what we can do. So DeFi basically can lower the barriers to entry and can help us create better financial services among communities. Or among maybe, I mean, regulation is a bit tricky, so there is always this is always a thing to consider. But there is a lot of opportunity how to create many DeFi products, which don't have to be regulated, they'll just create a better financial service. So you apply for a loan, in a few minutes you have the answer if you are eligible or not. At least that. Not even in a few minutes, but in a few seconds. So people in power, let's look through so Mark Zuckerberg with his Facebook and his imperialistic views, he's also looking into how to take over the payment ecosystem of the world. He has got giant user base when you think of Facebook, WhatsApp, Instagram combined. Of course, Putin is maybe the next person. George Soros, he actually proved many, many times that people who have a lot of money can influence lives of millions. And I mean, not only millions, but of all the nations. I'm not sure who remembers the 1992 when he broke the back of pound and, okay. IMF is another very interesting institution, but I would like to go into DeFi. Also ECB is a very interesting institution. So I live 2 kilometers far from ECB. And I mean, there is not much I can do about it. However, I would love to, but there is no open discussion. No one is ever interested at ECB in listening to what do you guys like? Do you like low interest rates? Do you like the financial services? Do you like this or that? No one has ever asked. So, of course, this is not the role of ECB. I'm just painting the picture that there is like few entities worldwide which have a lot of power and they can. Drive the monetary system the way they want. And also a big paradox, right? So as we saw recently in the US, there has been like trillions of money of dollars printed, and people are still required to pay tax. So, and also as someone mentioned in the previous presentations, the correlation between the crisis of like many people and the markets I mean, there is almost no correlation. How is that possible? So these are the questions which DeFi may address, may tackle. I mean, not now, as mentioned, right? Because DeFi is still very immature, but we'll see some moments. And also, very, very important topic to think like to the future is dollar as such, dollar as a world reserve currency. And as like one quote by Nixon secretary, you know, dollar is someone's currency, but it's a problem of 60%, 70% of the world. So what is DeFi? DeFi, by definition, is decentralized finance, refers to the shift from traditional centralized financial systems to peer-to-peer finance enabled by decentralized technologies built on the Ethereum blockchain. So, I mean, you don't have to memorize the definition. Just takeaway is that decentralized finance aims to disintermediate financial services. And therefore, we are using blockchain because it's the most convenient way how to build something pretty easily, pretty cheap, and how to create instant trust. Decentralization is very relative notion. So when I tell you decentralization, I mean, tell me what you think is decentralization. You may give me completely different answer than someone else. So, I mean, also in DeFi space, it's not clear like to what extent applications should be decentralized in order to, I mean, belong to the DeFi. But what is very important here to say that we can think of decentralization at several levels. So we either decentralize protocol or who owns the funds or like how do we go about price feeds. I mean, these are maybe the terms you might not be familiar with, but it doesn't matter. So imagine like basic application and you think of, okay, so on this layer, who is in the ownership of changing the layer, for instance? And when there is several layers to the application, then you can end up having like, wow, like so funds, they are not owned by me, but by someone else, pretty much just with the bank. So we might not be able to call it DeFi anymore. According to DeFiPrime.com, yeah, one remark. So in DeFi, there is no central authority saying, this is DeFi, this is the categories, these are the products. No, so you have like a few websites, I will list them at the end. Which you can use as a reference when you want to speak about DeFi. So DeFiPrime.com has classified like few categories of products. And for us, maybe the most interesting part are decentralized exchanges for the moment. And yeah, I don't see it, but lending protocols. Aha, lending and borrowing. So let's have a look at the lending and borrowing protocols. I'm not sure if you are familiar with this science, but these are all cryptocurrencies. And for instance, what is Compound.Finance doing? They are offering you opportunity to borrow your, sorry, to lend your cryptocurrency at better rates. Because they are better at matchmaking the demand and the supply. I mean, apart from other things, but how Compound.Finance has created their protocol is basically better matchmaking of demand and supply in terms of loans. So when I want to lend my money somewhere at better rates, they can do it for me. They can find the opportunity. Now it works only for cryptocurrencies, but it also works for stablecoins, for instance. So stablecoin, like the USDC coin, is USDC is pegged to dollar. And they can offer me a rate of 1.57 when I deposit. So 1.57 is even like way better than like the offer I can get from the traditional bank, right? And this is not only like, this is one of the many protocols which are now being built on DeFi and which are heading towards more maturity because there is more and more capital and cash flow flowing in. And therefore, also these rates may change dynamically. But most importantly for you as a takeaway is this is the key of DeFi. Better interest rates because of better matchmaking between demand and supply. Another protocol is Aave, for instance. Aave is very similar principle to what I showed you previously. And where you can have a look at these all protocols with an overview. What are the rates? I didn't put URL there. It's a loanscan.io, I believe. Mm-hmm. So on loanscan.io, you can check across the protocols in the market which protocol offers you the best rates. Of course, there is different conditions which may be applicable, but this subject for a further discussion. Very interesting are decentralized exchanges, but we'll show them later. Also, I would like to show you one of the products which also has fiat on-ramp, off-ramp. Fiat on-ramp, off-ramp means that I can directly go to my bank application and make a SEPA transfer, for instance, to Nexo. Well, in Czech Republic, I think this may differ. But still, if you are able to send money to Swiss bank account, then you should be able to use these services. And as you can see, like their borrow rates are 5.9 and 10%, and 10% is the rate which you get when you deposit certain either cryptocurrency or they even reward you for depositing cash like euros. So the rates at the moment are about 5% too. And when you compare like what Nexo is able to offer you now with what whoever else is able to offer you, it's a lot of difference. Important to say about Nexo, Nexo stems from Credissimo. Credissimo is a relatively old fund. They have been in fintech since about 20 years, well, 15 years, sorry. Okay, you may ask, so if this is a strong DeFi proposition, like better interest rates, transparency and many other features, why isn't DeFi mainstream? And this is a big question, and I'm not sure if you followed the previous talk, but yes, it's like average person, and I mean, it's a bit like generalization to say average person. It's very difficult first to understand what is this about, then to remove the perception that it might be the scam. And it's also very difficult to get used to that we are, in many cases, we are custodials of our own assets. So maybe, but here I'm going to list a few reasons of why DeFi isn't mainstream. And the first one is, I have been working in the industry since about 4 years. If you ask me what is DeFi and what is Bitcoin, I think I can do well, because I'm presenting now. But I bet I might not speak your language. I mean, in terms of, we are completely, like whoever works in decentralized finance or cryptocurrencies, after 2 years, you completely lose like the vocabulary you need to use to explain Bitcoin and DeFi to your grandmother, for instance. So this is very difficult. And like what I mean that we can't even explain ourselves is, you know, like, well, read the text, and this is our talk. So when you work in DeFi, this is how we speak, you know. I'm going to put this on my LinkedIn that I speak like other language, and is this. Because really only few people will understand. And that's great that only few people understand this, because I bet like many of these with more maturity and with like more time, many of these will be adjusted back to traditional finance vocabulary, so we all will understand each other. And I'm looking forward to that, really. And also the problem is like even the key people, they are not able to explain themselves well in many cases. I'm not sure if you follow Twitter, but Twitter is a great example of what kind of discussions do we have. So this is the CEO of one of the biggest exchanges in cryptocurrencies. And J.K. Rowling, the writer, she asked on Twitter, what is Bitcoin? Tell me. And this is his answer. So it's very interesting, like, I'll personally teach you how to buy a Bitcoin on Binance using GBP. That's pretty fair. But what comes as next? I'm not surprised that she said like, no, thank you, I'm not interested in listening to what Bitcoin is. Also, this is another CEO of another exchange, also very big in cryptocurrencies. And he responded even to fake Twitter account of J.K. Rowling. So that's the state of, excuse me? Exactly. Exactly, but the problem is that these people are seen as thought leaders in some way because they have a lot of followers. So of course, when she received a response like this from a person who has, 500K followers, she was like, wow, well, like this is this Bitcoin? So yeah, of course, they're like presenting their products, but this is a big, or another talk like, yeah, when someone tells you I'm a yield farmer, baby, like, would you understand? No. So the language is a big issue. Then second problem with entire DeFi, these interest rates you saw, they sound perfect now. But what if we have trillions in DeFi and we have hundreds of millions of users? What do we do next? Because now we can do this because demand and supply, it's pretty like attractive. There is many, many new people coming onto DeFi. So of course they are interested to pay more because they want to be at the forefront. But what if the market is saturated and what if we have really hundreds of millions of people in DeFi? The question is, will we be able to facilitate the attractive interest rates? And also, like, where is this like extra money coming from? If we are going to sustain the rates, how do we make sure that when someone like cashes out their Ethereum, there will be still enough liquidity for the cryptocurrency as such? And dollar question, we touched this. Also very important one is a regulation. So regulation, it differs per country. Not even in Slovakia and in the Netherlands, the regulation around Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies is the same. So this is a big problem, actually. Then patents, so we have big players looking into DeFi and they are very interested into taking over the markets. And the problem is like, if they will be able to patent something, then DeFi as such is done because it's not DeFi anymore. And of course, to compete with the user base Visa has and creating new product to onboard those people, yeah, you can imagine like what kind of effort can it be. And user experience, so I mentioned the Uniswap, and this is like, I'm about to make a swap on Uniswap. And I have to say like, it's fully okay if you don't know what's happening there. But here I want to showcase that again, it requires to be like advanced or at least very, very interested and very, very careful, because you really can lose a lot of money with like some minor mistakes. And question of trust. Trust is actually very interesting because, you know, when big banks, they make a market research and I mean, asking like clients, do you trust us? The answer is yes, we do. When someone outside banks, like some independent entity creates a survey about if people trust banks, the answer is no. And the question is like, why the disparity between one no and another yes? Because it's the same question. Do you trust banks? Yes, I do. No, I don't. But the problem is that there is a term, cognitive and affective trust. So cognitive trust is, yes, I trust my bank that when I go to ATM and I want to withdraw money, I can. I trust my bank that if I have 50 euros in my bank account today and I don't do anything by tomorrow there is also 50 euros. I trust my bank that if my salary is sent to the bank account, it stays there. So this is the cognitive trust. But then we have affective trust, whereas like I say, I don't trust my bank that it's trying to make the best for me. I don't trust my bank that is interested in like making the most out of their markets to provide me with better rates, to create like better experience for me. So this is very interesting, and therefore neobanks like N26 or Bung or many Revolut, therefore they are doing so well because they are customer centric. So therefore they want your feedback, they want your opinion, and they also are able to do way better with interest rates and other services. Yeah, I commented on this. And also one very important aspect of DeFi in the future could be leverage on real-time banking. So real-time banking is a big topic in neobanks, because traditional banks, they are not able to track your purchases and to create a better user experience for you. Okay, here we might have some issue with us being tracked by our bank, and bank knows everything what we are buying and where our spendings are going to. But the point is, like, we can also facilitate better security, better security and better user experience. So one of the examples of real-time banking is you are swiping your card here in Ostrava when you are using a tram or a bus, right? So you swipe your card, you swipe in, swipe out, right? And you do this, let's say, 30 times a month, and your bank sees this. And then they send you like a push notification, hey, like, why don't you buy a monthly prepaid card and you save, I don't know, 30%. So simple things like that, where bank will be able to offer you discounts or some offers, can really improve our experience, how do we engage with a bank. And of course, some more like hacks. I mean, hacks are a big issue. Like, I'm not sure to what extent, like, in Czech media is DeFi like presented, but there have been quite some hacks or some exploits of bugs. Or, I mean, this is like a very difficult topic, but it's very like important to realize that we are still very, very early. Okay, and yeah, lack of interest from traditional finance community. This is also what prevents DeFi from going mainstream. But that's, I think, understandable. Like, if you are a big bank and you don't have any clue what's happening on other floor in the, on other department, then, you know, how do you execute the innovation within your structures? Okay, where to start, maybe, with the DeFi? This will be a very brief list, and I would like you to understand that this is like what I think after like many years of experience in cryptocurrency, what I think is the best maybe to start off with. So first, I mean, important, educate yourself. Like DeFi at the beginning, it has to be your sort of passion or hobby at least. So I like bankless.substack.com. They are writing articles which are pretty understandable. Also for people who don't have any DeFi experience. Then DeFi Pulse is more like statistical side. So that they are presenting data and how DeFi is performing. At the moment, we have $8.84 billion locked in DeFi. I mean, what I mean locked in DeFi in very simple terms is that like someone put their cryptocurrency to work for them in order to earn interest. And we consider the cryptocurrency to be in a lock. So this is what we mean by the locked value. Then I like the channel on the YouTube. It's the biggest cryptocurrency channel, actually, called Data Dash. And almost every day you can listen to updates. Updates with comments on traditional financial markets, on cryptocurrency markets, on DeFi. And I think it's a very genuine, interesting content. Then I like the defiant.substack.com. Again, similar story as Bankless, but they also are making podcasts. And that would be everything from me. Thank you.
Okay, shall we continue in English?
What you guys, možno aj po slovensky a česky.
Okay, so let's see. Uvidíme, jaké budou otázky. Mm-hmm. Díky, Vláďo. Okay, so please, can you explain yield farming?
Yield farming, so I'll try to make it as simple as possible. So I was showing you certain interest rates you can get from depositing your cryptocurrency to earn the interest, right? So yield farming is basically you are exploring the best opportunities across protocols in DeFi, and you are like trying to figure out how to make the most out of it. So this is like very, very simple. And why yield farming? I mean farming like, because farming is like collecting and harvesting the interest you are earning.
Okay, so how is it likely for Czechia and other similar countries based on recent economic markets to end up like Venezuela or Greece or countries like that?
Yeah, this is a tricky one, but you know, like the problem with Venezuela, there is another problem. 60% or 70% of governmental spendings were covered by oil in the past. So during Chavez, the government was well off, so they were able to cover up for the expenses. But with a drop in the price in the oil price, they have a big issue. And another thing which is making Venezuela Venezuela, I mean like a country in deep crisis, is that it's sort of a battlefield between the US and their political interests and between the Russia and China. So unless Czechia is like has ambition to become a battlefield between the US and Russia and China, I think we are very far from any crisis like in Venezuela. But still, I would look into cryptocurrencies.
Thank you. This is a tricky one. Why is Ethereum blockchain, why is it used?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, actually, that's a very fair question, and the answer is pretty simple, because Ethereum is an open source project, has sufficient like resources in the community itself. There is sufficient documentation. When it comes to programming smart contracts, I mean, even I was able, you know, to learn in 1 week how to deploy very basic smart contracts. So it's purely about the community support, and everything else, it came with the simplicity of the code used. So the code is called Solidity, and most of the DeFi applications are built using Solidity.
Okay, another question. If I borrow, for example, one Bitcoin and I will lose it in trading, How can the smart contract force me to pay it back?
Okay, that's a very good one, because when I was saying, okay, you deposit something, you want to borrow something, some cryptocurrency. In the DeFi, we have to face over-collateralization. And the thing is that you always have to deposit something. So when I want to borrow one Bitcoin, I usually have to deposit 1.5 Bitcoin worth Ethereum or any other cryptocurrency. So this really depends on the protocol. Therefore, it's a bit like misleading to speak about lending, because when you want to borrow money from your bank, they don't tell you, okay, so you put here 1.5 million and you can borrow 1 million. I mean, it's nonsense, right? But in a DeFi space, it works the way it works. So over-collateralization is the safety measure, you know. So if you don't pay back, they will liquidate your position in the collateral then.
Okay, do you use a bank personally?
Yes, I do, because I still have to receive euros, but I use an online bank, Dutch-based. I don't have any like a traditional bank, and I hope I will never be required to go physically to the bank to make an appointment to open a bank account and all other stuff. So yes, I do.
Okay, and last two questions. Are country-based DeFi possible? Would be government interested in implementing such applications to automate financial sphere?
That's a good one, and I don't think there is any incentive for government to do that, because government as such is also leveraging on the intransparency of the financial system. That's the first. And the second is when we have a look that we have ECB, like in the Eurozone we have ECB, and then we have commercial banks facilitating the services. Like you being Czech, you can open the bank account with the same online bank I have, which is Dutch-based. So we will see this trend that within Eurozone, it wouldn't make any sense to try to create like, to stay within one regulation, to stay within one country, so to speak. And as mentioned, when it comes to governments, honestly, they're as like as big banks in terms of execution. So every innovation is very difficult for them to even think of. Of course, there are efforts, but I think they'll be just too late, you know, to deploy them.
And this is a HR or hiring related question. As a potential risk analytics, is there any job for me in DeFi?
risk analytic in finance? Because if so, then there definitely is. DeFi is now blooming, and there is many, even the protocols I was showing you, when you go to their website and you click on the job market now, because also of corona measures, they might be very happy to hire you even remotely. So I hope the person who asked this question will apply or will approach me for a further discussion.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Paráda.